Okay, so day two, finishing up the notes. Now that we know how important limits are to calculus, let's get the notation out of the way and do some examples of finding limits using a graphical approach and numerical approach where we make some t-tables. So, limit notation. Let me get out of the way here. F is a function defined on some open interval containing the number a. Now, this value of a, we're going to be allowing our x values to approach a particular value, a, and the limit is going to be the y value that the graph approaches. The function f may or may not be defined at a. You're going to see this through some examples. At the value of a, we may have a hole where the graph approaches and the graph is undefined at that hole, but yet it's approaching at the same point on both sides, and thus we'll still be able to find the limit. And sometimes we won't be able to. We'll explain why as we get to the end of this board. A function graph could be continuous or have a hole, like I just said, at a, or be broken at a. Now, the notation is the limit as x approaches a, we're going to let our x values, again, approach some particular value of a, the limit of a function is equal to L, and it's red. Again, the limit of f of x as x approaches a is L. Now, this value of L is a y value, a limit. You know, when we look at these graphs as examples, the limit of a function is the y value that that graph approaches, and we'll be approaching particular a from the left, and we'll have a left a one-sided limit on the left side. We'll be approaching a value of a on the right and have a one-sided limit coming in from the right. And then we'll decide if they're equal. Let me get out of the way and just do that. We can approach a from the left, and that is denoted by an exponent, which is negative, or just putting a minus sign in the upper right-hand corner. And we'll have the limit as x approaches a from the left of f of x equals some y value. Or we can approach a from the right, and that's denoted by a positive or a plus sign in the upper right-hand corner of a, or where the exponent would normally be. And so we'll be able to look at some graphs here in a second and look for limits from the left and the right, and if they are equal, then we're going to be able to state that there is a two-sided limit. And if they're not equal, well, then there is no two-sided limit. And basically in calculus, that's what you're most concerned with, is those two-sided limits. And so kind of a big deal knowing, you know, is the left and the right limit the same? If they are, the limit exists. If they're not, then the two-sided limit does not. Let's look at some examples. Yes, it's another day and I'm still making this video. So let's do five examples and get this done. Here I've got y f of x is equal to negative x squared plus 5x plus 6. This is a parabola opening down with the negative leading coefficient. It is a polynomial. There's one variable and all positive whole number exponents. So it is a smooth polynomial function. And here's the parabola opening down. I want to do these five examples in sort of, like I stated in the video at the beginning of it, a graphical and numerical approach. Then the next video is going to be doing limits using their properties in algebra. So I've already got the parabola drawn for us. And I want to look at the value of the actual function and the values of the limits. So f of 1 is equal to 10. Now whether I take 1 and plug it into the equation, or I just look at my graph at the x value of 1, which is this value of 1 is my a that I was talking about in my previous page of notes. So if I go to my x value of 1 and I go up to the graph, it's equal to 10. Now limits, though, are the y value of the function or the y value that the graph approaches as you approach a. So we're going to take this value of 1 and approach it again from the left and the right. So we're going to look at the graph and we're going to approach that x value of 1 from the left hand side, or from x values that are smaller than 1. So we're going to come up and you can see that it's approaching a y value of 10. Yes, this graph is defined everywhere, so it actually, the y value will actually be 10 at 1, but the limit as you approach 1 from the left, that you're, you know, when you're like at point, it's, you know, going to be like 9.99 something. As we approach it from the right, you know, we kind of actually go over 10, but then come back down and approach 10, the y value of 10, from both the left side of 1 and the right side of 1. So the left limit is going to be equal to 10. The right limit, with the positive exponent there, is going to be 10. And our left and our right-hand side limits left and right are the same value. And when your left and right limits are the same, or your one-sided limits are equal, then there's the two-sided limit exists, and thus the limit of this function is equal to 10 at 1. Over here, we have a little bit of a different situation. I've already worked out the algebra. I didn't want to just completely just, you know, give the picture without the equation, because we're going to, in the next section, going to be doing these algebraically, and I'd like to remind you of where holes come from in a graph. When your denominator of a rational function is equal to 0, or can be equal to 0, you get things like vertical asymptotes often. Sometimes you'll have, if your top degree is larger than the bottom degree by 1, you can have slant asymptotes. And when the 0 is able to be canceled out, like we have here, we have f of x is equal to x squared plus x minus 6 over x minus 2. But if I take the numerator and I factor it, the x minus 2 cancels out. So this reduced version of the equation, f of x is equal to 1x plus 3, that's like, you know, basically saying y equals mx plus b, that's an equation of a line. So this graph, or this function, crosses the y-axis at 3, has a slope of 1, so from the y value of 3 up 1 over 1 up 3 over 1 and so on. But since this was my original function and it was undefined at the value of 2, we get this hole. Now in my textbook, most of these questions, or half the questions, just give the picture and ask you to analyze the picture to find the limit. That's the graphical approach of finding limits. So we have a little bit of algebra and graphing review and the picture. So looking at this as my original function, because it is, what is f of 2? Well, f of 2, if I take 2 and I plug it into this equation, as I see here with my graph, I have a hole. The graph is, or the function there, is undefined. That's what I meant in my notes when I said the function could be broken or have a hole. The function may not be defined at this value of a that you're trying to find the limit at. And indeed, we are going to find the limit at 2. Now, the graph is undefined at 2, but as you approach 2 from the left, the graph is, again, coming up. You're using values, you're looking at x values that are less than 2 to the left. So come in from the left, we are approaching a y value of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So as you come in from the left, we're getting ever increasingly close to 5. So, you know, this function is not undefined at 1.999999. It's only undefined at that exact value of 2. So as you approach 2 from the left, your y value becomes, or approaches, 5. As you approach from the right, as you come in from the right, it's a hole, so it's going to be, the function or graph is going to, you know, come to that hole from that same y value from both sides, actually from this way. So it is going to approach 5 as you come in from the right, and then since your left and right limits are the same, your two-side limit exists of 5. And again, you know, the limit's not 5 everywhere. The limit as x approaches 2 from the left and the right, and thus, since they're equal on both sides, the left and right limits are the same on both sides, the limit at 2, the limit as x approaches 2, not at 2, but as x approaches 2 from the left and the right, your limit is equal to 5, even though the actual function at 2 is undefined. My next two examples are going to be pure graphical. I'm not going to include equations, and the last example, the fifth example, is going to be using a table. Okay, I said I wasn't going to include the equations, but as I was erasing the board, I remembered one of my best students just told me they were still struggling a little bit with piecewise functions. So, we have f of x is equal to x minus 3, and f of x is equal to 4, and x minus 3 is going to be used for x values that are less than negative 1, and at y equals 4, or f of x equals 4, is for when the x values are greater than or equal to negative 1. Now, what I've done here is dotted in the two equations. This has a slope of 1 and a y-intercept of negative 3. So y-intercept of negative 3 and a slope of 1. This is, of course, if you look at f of x, just y. Y is equal to 4 is a horizontal line. So I've made a horizontal line through y equals 4. But in a piecewise function, you don't just graph a bunch of equations or functions on one xy axis. You have to pay attention to when you want to use those. I only want to look at the line f of x is equal to x minus 3 or y equals x minus 3 for x values that are less than negative 1. So I'm going to come through here at negative 1. I'm going to find that line and I'm going to put an open dot there and highlight the part of the graph where my x values are, you know, less than negative 1, and get rid of the rest of this dotted line. The second equation, or the second part of my piecewise function, is f of x is equal to 4, y equals 4, horizontal line. I want to use that function for x values that are greater than or equal to 1, so I'm going to come down here to negative 1 again, go up to the graph, and this time make a solid dot, indicated by or needed because of that equal sign in my inequality, and highlight the part that's to the right. So this is my piecewise function, and we're going to answer some questions again graphically. What is f of negative 1? Well, at negative 1, my actual function value is equal to 4. The limit, as I approach negative 1 from the left, the little negative exponent, as I come in from the left side of negative 1, my graph is down here. So I'm approaching, my y value is approaching, or my limit is approaching, as x approaches negative 1, I'm getting closer and closer to a y value of negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, and negative 4. As I approach negative 1 from the right, so here I am to the right of negative 1, my x value is greater than negative 1, I'm up here, and all my y values actually are equal to 4. So as I approach negative 1 from the right, all my y values are actually at already and staying at a y value of 4. So my right-hand limit is positive 4. Now, I've been able to find with this piecewise function a left limit and a right limit. As my x values approach negative 1 from the left and negative 1 from the right, but my left and right hand limits are not equal. And if your left and right hand limits are not equal, then the two-sided limit does not exist. There is none. Okay? Now over here, I've got another piecewise function. It's a little bit different. I've got f of x is equal to 2/3 x minus 1, and I've taken the privilege or the I've already sort of dotted in that line. It's got a y-intercept of negative 1 and a slope of 2/3, so negative 1 and up 2 over 3. A little dotted line, I'll fill that in a second. And then I've got f of x is equal to 1. Well, the first part of this piecewise function is defined everywhere except for where x is equal to 3. So, as my previous board full of examples had, I've got a hole at an x value of 3. But unlike just the previous example I had up here a minute ago, I've got an actual another part of this piecewise function. It says, well, when x does equal to 3, well, I don't want it to be the same number. Let's make that 4. When f of x is equal to 4, at x equals 3. So when x does equal 3, my actual function value is equal to 4. So I have a function with a hole in it, and it's just sort of pulled out and then plugged in somewhere else. Piecewise function. So f of 3. Well, f of 3. If I'm using an x value of 3, not that one, the second equation, and my y value is 4. Or when I go to my graph and I see an x value of 3, okay, and my dot, that's open, so it's at, again, 4. The limit as we approach 3 from the left is equal to 1. Excuse me, as I approach 3 from the right, I'm still approaching a value of 1. And again, my left and right hand limits are equal, so the two-sided limit exists. Now, what if you have a function that maybe you don't necessarily know what it's going to look like graphically, and you don't have a graphing calculator handy? Last example. All right, last example. Limit as x approaches 0 of sine of x over x. Now, if this were like beginning of pre-calculus when we were studying rational functions, all of our problems had polynomials on in the numerator and the denominator. And if that were the case, and you have a value in the denominator that does, that allows the fraction to be undefined, then we a lot of times had vertical asymptotes. And if the top degree was larger than the bottom degree, or the numerator degree was larger than the denominator's degree by a value of 1, then you had a slant asymptote. But this is certainly not just a polynomial. We've got a trig function on top with a denominator of equal to 0. And if we just try and find the limit as x approaches 0, we can't find this function's value at 0, because if you plug in 0, you're dividing by 0, and that's undefined. And I don't really know necessarily what this graph looks like. So your other option is to, and it's a bit of a monotonous one, but to make a t-table, effectively. And don't make a t-table like you're trying to graph it. You are trying to find the limit as x approaches 0. So you need to get very, very close to 0 on both the left and the right-hand side. Don't just plug in, you know, like whole number answer, like just don't plug in like negative 2, negative 1, not that that would even work because you can't take the tangent of negative 2 or the sine of negative 2, but when you make this table of values to find the limit, make sure you stay very, very close to that a value, you know, where you're allowing x to approach both on the left and on the right. So as we can see, and I couldn't do this in my head, so I've already worked out these problems, as we approach a value of 0, from the left-hand side, my y values are getting, and they're already actually very, very close to 1, because, well, that's just what this function looks like, and these values are close to 0, it's just that they're all less than 0, so they're all approaching 0 from the left. Make sure you get closer in value to that a as you approach it from the left. And as we approach it from the right, 0.03, a little closer at negative, 0.02, a little closer at 0.01, you can see my y values are, you know, getting very, very close and coming up sort of the same direction on both sides, getting close to a value of 1. So the limit, as I approach 0 from the left of f of x, or let's just write the equation, or the expression, sine x over x is equal to getting close to 1. The limit from the right is also equal to 1, and thus the two-sided limit, so let's just write a final answer, well, I'll write it down here. The limit as x approaches 0 for the sine of x over x, the left and the right limit, right-hand limits are the same, so my two-sided limit is equal to 1, and if you were to actually sketch this out, it would look something like this, or maybe not sketch it, but with your graphing calculator, you would get something that looks something like this. But it's undefined at 0, so there's a hole there, as we discussed, because we couldn't plug in 0, made the function undefined. So that is your graphical and numerical introduction to finding limits in calculus. Next video will be finding these algebraically. Bam! Go do your homework.